Have a motion on the minutes of last month's meeting, December 20th, as emailed.
Make a motion to accept.
Second.
Discussion?
Zach, nice job on the minutes.
Yep.
I wondered how you would make them out.
There's a reason why it took a week for me to...
Zach, nice job on the minutes.
Thank you.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Director's report? What can you tell us you've been up to the last month?
Okay, so... Well, the year closed out, so now we got a whole bunch of statistics to look at, which is a lot of fun because it's the best thing we have for educated guesses. Last year, we responded to 961 emergency patients. So that doesn't count things like our standbys or fire scene stuff or details. This is just people who needed emergency medical care. 961 of them, that's up from 802 the year before. So significant percentage increase. Why did that happen? I think it's probably a combination of a lot of things, not least of which is just full complement of the full-time staff, being able to be more efficient. They're out there. They're bringing a lot of respect to the department, and with that, the community awareness of it. So there was a time where people wouldn't call 911 in our communities because they figured they could get to the hospital a lot faster than waiting for the volunteers. So now that they know that we're around, they're picking up the phone and calling 911 more often. We're also getting that local responder engagement. Those local volunteers of the impact shift and things like that. So getting word out that way and just being more efficient. So that's all, I mean, good news in the sense of whether somebody's medical emergencies can be good news. Looking at the breakdown, so there's a lot of ways to look at this. The nomenclature here is ambulance one is our primary ambulance. So it's irrespective of the actual truck that we're running out of. This is, but ambulance one is our on-duty crew, our full-time staff. And they responded and cared for 876 patients last year, which is the year before, they only treated about 650 or 640. So again, I think this is increased efficiency, the full-time staff, able to turn around faster at the hospital, more comfortable with their job and their duties in the community, and just being able to respond quickly. The remaining patients up to that 961 were treated by our per diem and our local volunteers. And they did that through a combination of the other two ambulances. We go back and forth about the need for that third ambulance and things like that. Not to get into that argument, but just we have some numbers for last year we can look at. So last year there were 60 emergencies in which we utilized the third ambulance as either the first or the second. So that means there were 60 instances in which somebody called 911 and one of our vehicles was out of service for whatever reason, either scheduled or unscheduled maintenance or something like that. So that's 60 times where we either had an ambulance available, which we wouldn't have otherwise for that patient, or we were able to keep another ambulance, a second one, available for the additional calls. And then beyond that, there were six documented cases that I could find kind of working through the numbers where we actually had all three ambulances treating patients simultaneously. So that's that minimum six crew members, six department members, combination full-time local, staffing three trucks. So that happened six times. So it doesn't sound like a lot of times, but just the other night I was in the CIPC meeting and we needed that third ambulance and we were able to respond with it. So We use it, and that's six times last year for that purpose. If you extrapolate that out, we're in the business of helping people. I don't want to lose that. But if we extrapolate that to dollars and cents, that 60 times, there's like 50-something times where I'll save you the nuts and bolts, but basically it works out, I calculated about $35,000 in revenue that we realized because we had that third vehicle available to backfill when one of the other vehicles was not available. So take that for what it is. $35,000 we realized because of that third truck.
So how many mutual aid calls last year?
So, yeah, mutual aid calls. I've got them on the last page of the thing, but I got it broken down here. What are we? So we did 60 mutual aid calls last year, which is 6% total calls. The year before, mutual aid was 5%. So about consistent, you know, we saw an uptick in volume in general, so we did more mutual aid calls this year, but as a percentage-wise, it still accounts for only 6% of our total calls. When you look at where we went, Greenfield is still kind of our number one player as far as mutual aid goes. That's to be expected. We're the closest paramedic service bordering them. And, you know, a spattering here and there of Conway, Turner's, Amherst, and things like that. Any other questions?
How many mutual aid did we have to come in to handle something that we couldn't handle?
Oh, you know what? I don't have those numbers yet. So those numbers come from Shelter Control,
yeah.
And they generate a year-end report, and there's usually a lot of work that I have to do to pull that out, but I don't have those yet.
Thanks, sir.
No problem. All right. Staffing, Teresa Emerson is in her full-time slot. And because she's in her full-time slot, actually looking forward to February, we have no scheduled overtime for any of our full-time staff members now. All of the normal open shifts that we typically have, so the 16 hours a week that aren't covered by the full-time staff are impact shifts, which are designed for our local responders. They're all being covered by local responders. So aside, barring sick leave or something unforeseen. So no scheduled overtime right now, which is really good. We won't be chasing our tail, so that everybody is excited about that. There was, I think I did this for the budget last month, but I think I forgot to mention it in the director's report, so I just plugged it in here. There had been that discussion a few months ago about clerk position, things like that. I just ran the numbers. And it would be an additional $15,000 annually, including benefits, to create another full-time position, which would be an EMT / clerk position, is what I envisioned.
That's to give additional hours to one of the existing EMTs?
Yeah, so basically what would happen, it would create a administrative clerk hourly position, like Sunday through Thursday or Saturday through Wednesday or whatever we needed during the day. And that person, because it's administrative hours, they'd be available to do the administrative duties during the day. But because they'd also be an EMT, if we had those additional calls or somebody called out sick or things like that, that they would be able to fill in or float around. So if we had somebody call out sick and they were supposed to work Saturday night, you know, it's like, okay, you're going to work Saturday night this night instead of working Wednesday and Thursday morning, would be how I would envision that. But we're a ways off. I mean, this is a very immature thought on my part, so I don't want it to seem like.
Yeah. Well, the reason I had mentioned that in the past is that instead of paying someone the EMT rate, it's just to have a part-time clerical worker that you could hire at a much lesser rate, and you might even not have to provide the benefits if it was, you know, small enough part-time to just come in during the weekdays to catch up,
yeah,
to keep on top of stuff.
Yeah, the $15,000 additional that I factored in, the reason that costs so little for a full-time position is because they're serving double duty and able to backfill and do things like that. So I imagine somebody who wasn't able to cover those shifts or something like that would be probably more than $15,000 a year. And then I put this in here twofold, and I'm sure you can read between the lines. if we're going to do annual reviews, should probably think about it soon. Last year, my annual review was delayed to the point where we didn't finalize it until September, and the recommendations of this board are still held up in committee in Deerfield. So, the new ambulance replacement still due in March. I think we have a date in early March to do either final inspection to receive it or finalize the paint as the last step or something like that. So that's right on track. We had a mechanical failure.
Yeah. Jack, going back to your evaluation.
Yeah.
When is the evaluation due?
Well, one would presume it would be due for the start of the fiscal year.
Do you have a date set for your employee reviews that you're working on? So you don't have anything on paper yet, correct?
Right.
Do you kind of know when you'd like them for?
I would like to see it as soon as possible. Mm-hmm. We need to work out how we're going to do this and implement it. But yeah, it's been, you know, left undone for way too long. Mm-hmm. Okay. And we need to start doing it.
Then, Mr. Chair, can we point a you want to appoint a committee to do the review? Mm-hmm. Make a motion. I'd recommend Bob and Gary because they have experience as EMTs. Mm-hmm. Would you guys be willing to do that?
Sure.
What do you think, Kevin?
Sure.
And come back for a review, of course. Sure. But
yeah, that's fine. Yeah.
And we all can give input to them if we want as well.
Mm-hmm, that's great.
I'd like to make a motion that Gary and Bobby be charged with evaluation for Zach.
Are we going to do just Zach, or are we going to do all of the employees?
Zach would do the employees, right?
We'll do Zach, and he'll do the rest of them.
Yeah.
Okay.
Sounds good to me. Second?
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed?
So Bob, you guys want to get it done?
Tomorrow?
Well, I know Gary just sitting around doing nothing. You may be a little busy tomorrow. Did you want to say to set a date for you want to get it done by?
But when I said, you know, as soon as possible, I don't really mean it hasn't been this month or something, but, yeah. You know, what we were talking about at one of our meetings is to, you know, to get other templates as to how to, you know, we all basically understand, you know, what needs to be done. We just wanted to have it very standardized so we can do the same process for everybody, you know, and that way, you know, there's no questions. But we have, you know, I don't think our town has ever done that way.
Right. No, I would think we have a good job description for our director. I would base his PMP off his job description. Mm-hmm. And I would think that'd be the best way. That's really what we want.
Maybe Bob and I should get together. We'll come up with a plan and we'll do some research and
Excellent. Find
out what we need to do.
All right.
Thank you.
All right. Okay, well, thank you. Speaking of the rest of the department employee reviews, I've been remiss. I haven't got a chance to do it. My intention is to, you know, get it done from a calendar year standpoint, so that way they're done once we enter into budget season. So if Deerfield changes to the merit-based or whatever, at least that information would be available come budget time if it's going to affect the following years.
I would think as we get, and again, I would take to see what Deerfield said, but I think it probably makes sense to be done before the end of the calendar year so that we'd be ready to just, we'd be able, if there's adjustments we make in wages that we'd have in our budget before we submit it. So, mm-hmm. I think we're probably working from behind the eight ball right now, but, you know, that'd get better, right? You know, yeah. Once we get the form put in, I mean, next year that would be a goal to get it done before the end of the calendar year.
Yeah.
No one likes to do evaluations, but.
I have a question. Who in Deerfield sets the COLA, if there is one?
I don't.
Who in the Sunderland sets your COLA? You just walk into
it? Personnel committee makes a recommendation.
Yeah.
They make a recommendation to us.
Okay.
And we actually have a formula. Here's a form, and I don't have it right at the tip of my.
But it might be helpful for the DFL.
Yeah, but we they look at one of the consumer price index. And yeah. There's a number of things that they. Although the last couple of years, it's been zero, or very, very low.
Understood.
So
then the selectmen make a recommendation.
Yeah.
I think in Deerfield there has been cost of living increases given anyways. I'm not
sure. Right, well, there have been more times.
Really? Yeah.
Someone gave one last year, right?
Mm.
Yeah. Waverly did too.
We'll give you something back by next meeting. Great. If that's what everybody agrees to.
The international ambulance. Kip called me because he saw it on the side of the road with a wrecker in front of it. Kip, I assure you, you were the fifth person to have called me regarding that incident, so I appreciate your...
I called him pretty quick because yeah. I was going to bring the other ambulance over.
Yeah.
Somebody beat me to it.
Had no effect on patient care or anything like that, but, you know, it affected my well-being to hear that this thing... It's the coolant system on this truck, and... We've been taking the international down to Nutmeg in West Springfield for a couple years now, and we're very happy with their service. We have been chasing this problem, and they know we are not happy that we have been chasing this specific problem, which we were assured at the last incident had been solved. So it's back in service. They got it back in service very quick. It's just an issue trying to figure out what's going on. So,
what exactly is going on?
There's a coolant hose that pops off. And, I know.
Kind of an important thing.
Yeah. Right, exactly. So it happened, basically it happened once. This is, you know, a year and a half ago. Uh-oh. Got it fixed. Then a month later, happened again. Okay, that was weird, maybe a fluke, whatever, we'll keep an eye on. The third time it happened, which was a couple months ago, now it's like, there's a problem, right?
Right.
Two's a coincidence, three's a pattern. So they tracked the problem down to something that was overpressurizing, some sort of recirculation thing that wasn't opening or whatever at the overpressurization, and it was exceeding the limits that the hose clamp and everything was designed to handle. We were assured, now that we know what the problem is, we've fixed it, you're all set to go. And it's been fine until it wasn't. So, I don't know. We're still, it's back in service. It seems to be running fine, but it's still,
anytime.
Yeah, we're still trying to sort that out.
It was a good story after it, though. I mean, when it happened, I called Zach, and then somebody else sung down the air and brought the Wheatley truck right down there, and
nice.
The transfer was pretty...
Yeah,
they didn't lack in time, but the following day they had like three calls in a row in the morning, and they were all kind of serious. And the first ambulance was already committed to one call, and then a second call came in Waitley, and then a third call came in Sunderland. Like, and they handled those three calls pretty well, you know, and they were all serious incidents. And
the reason that I called Zach was a couple days prior to that, I was in Northampton at the fire station, and I was speaking with their director, and we were talking about the ambulances and stuff like that, and he was saying that they work on their ambulances pretty much all the time, but when they don't, they bring it, to this dealer in West Springfield, and that's why I was just curious to see, you know, if we were at the same place, if it was a good place. Yeah, I think it was.
Yeah. So. Some capital.
They've been servicing Northampton and Amherst trucks for too. So I had discussed with Kevin Scarborough, the highway superintendent in Deerfield, about, you know, what type of things could we bring that international to the highway department for. Tire swaps, which seems obvious. oil changes, brakes, you know, like, you know, is there something that we can do, and, you know, how do we go about reimbursing or making sure, you know, that everybody's being covered? So that's something that is still in the works, trying to figure out, you know, it's...
Well, we have a great garage for working on.
Well, that's exactly the point. You know, the issue though is, you know, does the Deerfield Highway Department get in the business of invoicing South County, and at what rate, and right. you know, and all those things, and liability? You know, if none of them are certified emergency vehicle right. repair right. technicians, what are we looking at? So, also an option, but. Okay. Oh, speaking of vehicles, during the IMA, we transferred all the equipment over through the IMA. We also, things like the vehicles need to be transferred over, registrations and ownerships. In the fold, in all of these town administrators changing over the past few years, we realized going through the paperwork that that has not happened with the Sunderland and Whately trucks, that they haven't officially been transferred over to Town of Deerfield ownership. So this came up the other day. Carolyn S. and I discussed it, and it seemed to me just kind of a matter of administrative. We'll get the town administrators on board just to make sure everything happens. She thought maybe this board needs to vote or recommend that the town administrators participate in this or something. This is a procedural question that I think is above my pay grade, but it seems like it was already implied through the IMA. It's just a matter of we haven't done it yet and we need to do it.
When we get that new ambulance, it's my understanding that it's replacing the Ford from Whately.
Correct.
What's going to happen to that vehicle?
That gets traded in for...
It's traded
yeah,
in.
Yeah. I forget what trade-in value they're given for it, but it's maybe $15,000, I think, for it.
Is it?
I recommend that you work with the town administrators of Whately and someone.
Yeah, Roger.
Tom can follow up on his perk.
Okay. Gary, do you think that Whately ambulance is worth more than that for us to keep? Because I don't know. Or is it something that, you know, we end up collecting old ambulances? I don't know.
Well, it's been fairly dependable.
That's
for its age.
You were always saying that it was really a good truck.
I mean, when I was in charge of it, I mean, we did regular maintenance all the time. I mean, I put a ton of money into it for maintenance. You know, I mean, one of the major problems with them Fords was the oil pans rotting out, and we replaced that. Cost me like $2,800 to do it. You know,
that's
yeah.
a common thing on those,
because they have to lift the motor up. It's unbelievable. So we did that. I mean, all of those things have been taken care of, and. You know, when Phil used to come up to inspect it, I mean, he'd crawl underneath that thing and went all through it, and he couldn't find anything wrong. He says, you know, it's over 10 years old. He said, you should be replacing it, but I can't find any reason to tell you have to, you know.
Yeah.
So, you know, it's been a dependable unit.
It's like a 2000 or something?
Yeah.
2001,
yeah.
I think.
What? One of the other 2000.
Yeah. I mean, it's only got 30,000 miles.
Yeah.
You know, of course, the engine hours are higher, but.
Yeah.
What are you thinking, Kip?
I don't know. I just a lot of times I hear, you know, I know in Deerfield we recently traded in some things that didn't really get a lot of money for. You know, then like 2 weeks later, it's like, you know, geez, if we had this other vehicle, we could do it. I said, well, darn, you know, we just gave one away.
Well, I suggested it to my fire chief to possibly look into purchasing it as a like a rehab vehicle for fires. You know, because it would be ideal. I mean, you have something. If we have something like that locally that can go to the fires in the three towns, like in the summertime when it's super hot out, now you got an air-cooled building or vehicle you can get into.
Yeah.
In the wintertime when the guys are freezing, they got a place to go into for heating, you know, and it may be something, maybe even as a regional thing with the three towns, we could create something like that, you know. Here's a vehicle that we already own.
Right.
I mean, we don't have to go buy something.
Right.
You know, it'd take a few bucks to revamp it, to be their needs, but it might be a good idea.
When do we need to make a decision to trade that boat? Would be at the time of the possession of the new truck?
Yeah, March. Yeah, whenever we receive, accept the delivery of the new truck, they would want payment.
Never towed out.
Right.
You know?
It's a good thought for buyers.
Well, that's what I'm thinking. That's...
Yeah, I'll let you guys fight it out. I mean, I don't want it to transport patients any longer, but...
It's the only thing. Get a new building and give us a fourth pay.
Here we go.
Well, there's no drugs. It doesn't have to be heated.
That's true. But doesn't Deerfield have a rescue truck?
I think they did.
They do. I might start a fire department.
They have a truck that they'll get people in.
I believe they have a rescue truck.
We could look into that.
Well,
that's the thing. I mean, you take the cabinets out of there and put a couple rows of seats in there where you can get, you know, six or eight firefighters to sit in there. And that way, you know, they can do shifts a lot easier than calling in the mutual aid people, you know, because that's what happens now. I mean, you get people who get burned out, and you got to call in mutual aid to just bring a crew, another crew to go in the building or whatever, you know, for a fire overhaul. And this would, I think it would definitely be an asset, you know, to the three towns.
Well, we should be able to talk to the four chiefs, right, Bobby?
Yep.
Okay. See what they're saying. That also could be a service at South County Health Reform also.
Mm-hmm.
Right. You know.
What else you got, Zach? Working on the budget.
Budget, let's see. Facility housing, I think even if, you know, everything happened expediently, I think it's not unreasonable to think that we're probably still going to be where we are past July 1st.
Well, maybe.
Maybe.
Well, someone has to go to the fire district and ask if they would accept this.
Well, this is, right. So our current lease with the South Deerfield Fire District is through 2018, 1 year renewals through 2018. So I believe, if I'm reading it correctly, the lease covers us, but in the very least, to send an emissary to their prudential committee and, you know, give them an update. I'm sure they're well aware of what's happening in this room, but at least to have a conversation with them. So,
good idea.
They feel included.
Sunderland and Waitley, I don't know.
The respective fire departments as well. Just to make sure that.
Yeah. Should we invite them to one of our meetings to discuss it, or?
Well, I think so. Yeah, somebody's going to just go and talk to them and just make sure. Because I think the last one they said, Jack, didn't they just say they would renew for one more year? Wasn't that the conversation?
No, I looked at the South Deerfield.
I just want to, I don't want to assume anything. I don't know what their plans are. I do think it's appropriate to go and talk to them and say, hey, look, these are our plans. These are our options. We're not going to be done right away, but we're going to be done soon. Do you have a problem? Mm-hmm. Can we have the same
rates?
Can we try to have the same rates? And we're going to try to be out as soon as possible. I just think that's good.
Yeah. I've had informal conversations with them, and it's my understanding that, you know, we could stay there at the same and pretty much leave whenever we want.
Okay.
That prorate thing. But I will talk to Bill, and if I need to go to the Prudential Committee to get a definite answer on that, I'll do that.
That's fine. That's good. I just think they're just good business. I mean, that's just respect. They're just showing them respect.
Now, is there going to be any kind of conflicts with them or anything on the driveway and everything?
No, that's all good.
No?
Because we don't have to cross their property at all.
Entrance.
No, okay, same entrance, but the road that's in front of the fire station is not fire station's property.
That's the way we designed it.
Looking at the current lease with South Deerfield Fire District, the data lease is through June 30th, 2018, and it does state no change in the rent amounts for the following year. So, but
still pick them up to speed.
Wouldn't hurt to have the conversation.
Right. Yeah, just talk to them. That just makes sense.
All right. Budget stuff, no changes, really significant stuff. I think I have a better handle on benefits. Health insurance costs for the following year went down like a tick, but our Franklin Regional Council of Governments FERCOG fee for the use of the radio system is going up something like 48.3%, which is 5,000 to 7,000 something. This is based on their Council of Governments Radio Committee realizing, reworking the numbers that they should have been charging everybody more from the beginning, apparently. This is their fee to us to use the radio system, and this is covering their expenses. So we haven't received official word yet. This is still kind of like their committee met and then talked to the EMS committee, and the EMS committee is saying this is, you can expect to see this coming, but I've included that increase inside the budget. So
the age of the radio system is getting longer.
Yeah.
Or electronics.
From my ears, it's long in tooth and not too much longer.
It was already old technology when it was installed, and that was 10 years ago. They got such a good deal on it because it was new old stock and new stock that people were transitioning out of.
And they've had a hard time having people service it. And you're looking at, what, $8 million to replace it, something like that, I heard?
Yeah, I don't know.
Yeah, it's an expensive system. We were lucky to get the grant when we got it last time to install the whole thing, but
where is that up at?
It's all over
the county.
Oh, okay. They have different.
They have repeater stations all over.
Yeah, multiple sites and uplinks and all that.
Okay.
Yeah. I have a question. Does that mean that every municipality that uses it is going to have an increase?
Yeah, there's a
department.
Yep, there's a user in every municipality. There's fire, there's police, and if you've got an ambulance, that's three charges you get on your town budget.
So Deerfield will be charged three times.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Two now. You don't get. Well, you get fire.
Well, you guys would get charged four times. Yeah. Old Deerfield pays there. I don't know who does their budget, but.
Right. So we have four.
Deerfield Fire Department, South Deerfield Fire.
So then Sunderland way they wouldn't get the EMS charge.
You don't. Well,
well you'd be paying part.
You'd be paying
part. You're not getting EMS. You're not getting EMS because South County is paying that.
Yeah, wait, so you're giving it for the assessment, but right, the town is paying it, right?
Yeah. It'll be a regional.
But it really isn't a regional charge, it's a town charge.
Correct, and it's based on either population size or square miles or call volume. They have some sort of formula to determine your usage of the system and, yeah, and what
it's per doing. Capita.
Yeah,
it's for somewhere to count all three communities.
Yeah.
Is that system different than the one where they, like a police officer can see how many times the fire department showed up at a house and all that. Is that a different computer
it
system?
This isn't a computer system. This is
radio.
Just this, yeah. Totally separate.
Okay.
So I have a question. In your budgeting, do you get as deep as figuring the health insurance costs, or does Deerfield handle that separately?
You
see, I should know this
one.
South County, we're responsible for all that.
You know that your insurance system is going up 10% July 1. So
that's great.
So you need to know that.
I'm waiting to get, as I said in the last meeting, there's always a difference between what I calculate based on the formula and what Barbara's office and comes back with. So I always try to, I've learned to coordinate with her to figure out, you know, what as best our actual charges are going to be. So I'm still waiting to get some numbers from her, even like county retirement and things like that, which are billed.
Right. I do know that we just found out that our assessment's going up 10%. So. Okay.
And that's, and you got the Hampshire County.
Yeah.
Yep.
They must have had some cases then.
Well, they haven't had any increases for.
It's been pretty level for
pretty level for a long
years.
Time.
Yeah.
But the other thing is, my wife works for an organization, and the prescription drugs have been a huge thing, and they're really promoting people use that. I said, cannot RX.
Right.
The drug costs are huge. It's like these EpiPens that people, they keep them because they need them, but they went up to like $600, but you can buy them to a place in Canada $315. Yeah. And then there's some drug for hepatitis C. It's $100,000 for 8 pills. You can get it through Canada for about $21,000. You know,
it's crazy.
It's crazy.
That it, Mr. Zach?
And the USDA grant. I spoke with the representative from USDA directly, she, in no uncertain terms, said that we wouldn't qualify to recuperate any costs for the current ambulance since the money is only available for projects that the town couldn't otherwise raise money for. So the fact that we've already appropriated the money, she's like, right there, you're disqualified. And then she says, looking forward to future projects, you'd run into a similar problem just with your history, but also it's capped at a certain dollar amount. And she said, for an organization like us with our coverage area, any grant money would be capped at $20,000, which is $20,000 we wouldn't get otherwise. But in the scheme of a $300,000 ambulance, she's like, you know, you got to do one of these. And she forwarded me, she said she can't provide an official ruling unless you submit the entire grant and then they can stamp it. But she goes, it's clear to me what the outcome would be. And she forwarded me some communications she's had in the past with the Whately Town Administrator and things like that, just kind of outlining all these bullets. So
I read that and I found it really interesting. And I'm believing this, but I can't wait to get to the next one of these meetings when that guy from Washington stands up and tells me all this stuff, and I'm going to tell him he's full of...
Yeah. Mike Tomlin, careful, Mike.
Yeah.
Pittsburgh Steelers coach.
Yeah.
Didn't use the right words the other day on TV.
Oh, yeah.
On Facebook.
On Facebook Live.
Just to the point, if we were to put money aside, we wouldn't qualify either.
Is basically what she's saying. She's like, this money is intended for communities who need this and cannot afford it, and it seems like you guys can afford this.
If we put $100,000 a year for an ambulance replacement, you're not going to get a grant.
So in other words, we'd be better off not putting any money aside and applying for it.
Just wait until I'm broken down on the side of the road. And yeah.
$20,000.
Isn't it crazy, though?
That's what I do a little bit.
Well, but that's what we're in trouble with. When the governor start cutting local aid, they'll look at, there's a town now on this side of the river south of us that has $2.5 million in stabilization. And it's like, well, you got 5,000 people in your town, you got $2.5 million stabilization. And then what the people in Boston say is, well, you can afford to pay, you're just not willing to pay. So it's like, well, no, people are saving their money to buy things that they need. Why are you holding that against them? You really shouldn't, but you're damned if you do and damned if you don't.
Yep.
They don't have prices and get penalized.
Well, they don't have a problem if you increase your tax rates. Mm-hmm. You know? They think that's okay. People in Boston think that's okay. For out here, I think we have set realistic budgets. I think we're a little more frugal, and you try to pay for stuff when you can, and that's a foreign concept to some people.
Seems like it for me. Any updates on the building progress?
Did you have another question?
I was just talking about continuing on budget. There was a discussion last week, started but not completed on retained earnings. What are you going to do with them?
Yeah, I mean, we still have that amount. I'd like to see, I think it seemed like the consensus was to apply it absolutely to the assessment balance to either.
There was no decision made.
It seemed like that, but you know, I still don't know where these budget numbers are going to fall from Barbara and things like that. So, you know, I didn't want to pull the trigger on that and then find out that, yeah.
You had three options you discussed last meeting, and there was no discussion after that. I was just curious.
I noticed that as well, yeah. But
If I could, Mr. Chair, Carolyn is unfortunately wasn't able to attend, but she said she has been either today or very recently been at a meeting, and I guess there was a discussion. Now, Zach, you have to get a doctor's signature on purchase of oxygen and some very basic supplies. She was wondering how that affects you and does it affect
you.
It's like a yearly signature, though, isn't it?
No, this is something a little bit different. Right now, we have something called standing orders, so a doctor out in Boston decides that we can do X, Y, and Z. As a paramedic, we're allowed to go outside of that and say, actually, the patient needs this. It's a little bit outside of that, but I know they need it. And we can call a doctor up on the radio, and they can approve it in real time. Anytime that happened in the past, we would get the doctor's signature once we deliver the patient to the hospital, just attesting to the fact that, yeah, this is what I gave an order for. Now, and this comes down from the DEA or the FBI, they're interpreting the regulations as they're written to mean that anytime a paramedic or an EMT gives any medication in the ambulance to include oxygen and normal saline or sterile water to irrigate a wound, we need to have a signature by the physician at the emergency room when we drop the patient off. Because it qualifies as a medication administration that is ordered by a physician. Everybody in EMS understands this to be just, an old regulation that was never designed to fit around standing orders in EMS, but this is how the DEA is saying it. So from OEMS, the Physicians Council, kind of our doctor gods, all the way down through the regional councils, is that, all right, if this is what the DEA wants right now, we're going to have to do it, but it's not going to last long because the doctors in the ED are going to be, I'm trying to treat patients, I don't need to sign off on oxygen, these people are competent. But what it means for us practically, operationally, in our electronic patient care software program, I check a box in the software that says require doctor's signature whenever medication is administered. And so when our crews drop the patient off and they're writing their run report before they leave the hospital, it'll say, you need a doctor's signature because you gave medication. They'll go to the doctor and they'll say, doc, I need you to sign my computer. They'll sign it, capture electronically, hit OK, and everything will be done. Presuming no significant delays in getting the doctor's attention in the ER. I mean, we know what that can be like. It's one extra step. We're already getting patient signatures every single time we treat somebody. So it's something we're used to doing. It's just a matter of how cranky those physicians are going to be.
So Zach, who do we have to talk to? That maybe the DEA or whoever, they need to reconsider their.
It is federal. The OEMS works alongside. It's the Physicians Council, so it's.
So they should be lobbying.
Yeah, and they're on it like white on rice. I mean, like if you think people in this room are like this is crazy, I imagine what those conference rooms in Boston on 99 Chauncey Street are like right now. So
yeah, because it's federal. I mean, it wouldn't be so much us talking to our locals,
right.
Our local rep and state senator, but we could always send a letter to either McGovern and or.
Sure. Yeah. And my understanding is it's the regulation, too, which is a simple bureaucratic fix as far as these things go. It's it wouldn't require an act of law that I'm aware of as much as just
change
of
wording. It just gives us something next time we talk, next time we see them, something that we can talk to them about.
Yeah.
A very simple thing. And again, it's more important to talk to the staff, but just to bring it to their attention. All right. Thank you.
Old business, do we have any updates on the building or anything new about that? No. Status quo. Everything's still good.
Yeah, everything is still good. I guess I don't have anything more to do with it, so I can't give you any progress reports. But all I know is, last I heard is everything is full steam ahead. I've heard through different board members in our town that different things have been applied for to deal with
the permits
and stuff like that. So.
it's moving somewhere.
Yeah. I mean, it seems like, from everything I understand, it being a gift, there can be no communication or discussion, you know, otherwise it would be, you know, by proxy and all that stuff. The conversations I've had, the things I've heard, I do feel comfortable that DA is receptive or understanding of, you know, what they would be creating and building, that they wouldn't be deciding something in a vacuum. So
what exactly does that mean? They're going to consult with yourself or this board?
They can't consult with me because I'm a town of Deerfield employee. But it would seem that they're more than capable and have already figured some smart folks that they can't consult with.
I just got one, or a couple. One thing is that somehow, when we're building our budget, if there's things that we're going to have to put into that building, and I think Kip was starting to talk about that last week or last month, whenever our last meeting was, you know, that somehow we need to know what we may have to budget for that, you know, for furnishings and that kind of stuff. And so I don't know, and I understand what you're saying. I just don't know how we go about that. Or, again, it shouldn't come. Or maybe we have an idea of what we need for furniture, or I don't know. Are we providing flooring or light fixtures or overhead doors?
I don't think we have to provide anything like that. I think what we'd have to provide would be, you know, maybe lockers,
desks,
chairs, you know, things of that.
Exhaust system. So I want to clarify one thing. I did mention that last meeting, and I had a figure of $60,000. Well, Whitley had looked at a system for $60,000. They wound up getting something that cost like $17,000. But that was like bottom of the barrel type thing. So yeah, it's still an expense that we have to think about.
So do we ask Zach to kind of have a basic understanding what a plan would look like, and should he start costing what would go to furnish something like that? Yeah, how do you go about that?
Well, I would think that, and I'm going to throw it over to him, but I mean, he could look up and find he needs, I don't know, say five desks and five chairs and five file cabinets. I mean, I think I've seen everything that they use, and it would probably be best in the landfill. You know,
what did Mike Rock have to buy up in Highland for his?
Yeah, that's a great question. Yeah,
you know, well, besides what he might have taken over from, you know, where he was. But
yeah, Corinthian leather, I would think. You know,
ooh, fine.
It's a similar size building.
Conklin Furniture in Holyoke.
Yeah,
it's a place to do all your buying.
Where's that?
In Holyoke.
Betty Bar.
It's close. Next door. Conklin Furniture.
Oh, I know that. It's, yeah.
Got that big warehouse they advertise on the radio.
Yes, they have now. I have a question though. When did your retained earnings recertify? Every year.
When is it?
Yeah, when is the last one?
July,
something. Yeah, it's after the first of the fiscal year, whenever the rest of the town of Deerfield's money is.
So
I saw that in September.
Well, that's what I'm wondering. If you're going to move in July, August, September, you might be able to use that money, depending on when you move in.
This is money from, what are we in now, FY 17? This is from FY 15. Yeah. Right, and that was right. I think one of the discussions for the retained earnings is, you know, these expenses associated. So again, I don't want to.
But that doesn't have to be. When do you have to make the decision? When at the budget time, right?
Yeah.
So you gotta make it now.
Yeah.
Right. I think in the big scheme of things, I would think that $6,000 or $7,000 would cover all that type of furniture easily. I can't imagine.
You online?
How much you spend in your
room? Did you put some stuff online?
Is that something
online? And they're used, and they use some stuff.
Refurbished.
Nice.
Oh, I'd have to go look. I'd have to try to find that somewhere.
But, and again, I was just wondering, I mean, that's probably what we should be talking, because, you know, that Deerfield Finance Committee beats us up.
Exactly. They need a budget ASAP.
We should have answers for you. I don't get me wrong. We should have answers.
Okay. Somebody's reviewing your budgets now, right?
Huh?
Your finance committee working on budgets?
Yeah, we wing it.
No,
we're here. We don't mean it, no.
Yeah. I'm just saying that I don't want another month to go by and not have a budget.
I'm just very interested what the governor's going to say in about a week now.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I'm very interested in what, the 24th, I think. I'm very interested in what he's going to say.
Well, you guys will all be down there. You can twist his arm and tell him what you want.
I want a new red shiny fire engine.
There you go.
That's all I want for Christmas,
Governor.
Well, actually, I'd like to bring up that the old ambulance thing again.
Yeah.
As far as keeping it as a rehab vehicle, because I see a lot of benefit to that, because if there's a major fire in one of the three towns, or mutual aid even, you know, Zach supplies an ambulance to stand by, but if he has to take a firefighter or a patient to the hospital, then he has to call in another ambulance to stand by. And this way you would have something there that could have some of the basics on it, could have oxygen, could have, you know, water, all kinds of
BLS ambulance.
Yeah, it'd be a BLS, basically. I don't know if you'd have to, what kind of loopholes you'd have to go through to do that. I mean, you wouldn't call it, you wouldn't be transporting with it, so it wouldn't be.
If it's, I'm sorry, it was.
You would just have some equipment on it to continue to stand by when that ambulance, the standby ambulance, the paramedic.
If it's not an ambulance, you don't even need to speak to Phil. I mean, it's just like any other fire department vehicle at that point.
Yeah, you just go ahead and put whatever you want on it, probably, and use it as a standby. You know, you'd have a lot of potential there, you know?
Yeah.
I mean, if the ambulance, the standby ambulance that you provide has to go to the hospital, then you got something there for the firefighters to go into. You know, if somebody needs oxygen or just to cool down or warm up or whatever.
From where I sit, you know, our budget for that new ambulance includes that trade-in value, which I don't have right in front of me right now, but I can get you the specific amount. You know, so like I would be looking for that.
That was like $6,000.
Yeah. I don't think it was that much, actually.
For certain, that $5,000 or $6,000 seems to keep popping up.
I can track that down pretty easily.
I mean, either way, you're never gonna buy something to
exactly
put in that position.
Right. So
you have something already.
That's equipped.
Utilize it, you know.
Yeah.
I mean.
Yeah. I mean, I would only ask that I have access to that vehicle all the way up until the day I don't need it, and then. And then I need whatever, you know, offset.
I kind of think it's a community service to, you know, to our other, you know, service providers. I mean, basically,
yes,
we just something that we're giving back to the other three towns. You know, instead of basically throwing the ambulance away, you could say that, you know, you're offering it, and see if the chiefs want something like that. If they think it's a value, then why wouldn't you do that just to help them out?
You wouldn't really need that ambulance once you get one.
Next month, along with our other project.
Yeah.
All right, Gary and I will check into that a little more and give you a report back next month.
Perfect.
Right.
Good.
Can I just ask a question? There was talk of an interceptor truck, too, at some point in time?
This is looking towards the future. It was
down the road?
It would be, you know, if we're doing intercepts or anything like that, instead of using an ambulance to do it, there are cheaper ways to do it. But I don't have any plans or anything like that.
Okay, no plans for that?
No.
All right. I'm just saying, you know, if you're going to go three ambulances and then you know, keeping a fourth here, and I understand what the use is for and that, but then all of a sudden spring an interceptor truck here very shortly, I think taxpayers would be a little upset with that. But I just wanted to check to make sure. Okay, so that's off the table. Right. Thank you.
Good question. Get back around the bus.
Anything else to come before the board this month? Shortest meeting on record.
Make a motion when you're there.
Second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.